One of the things, the first incidents that happened when Dasharatha Maharaj was very, even before he got married to Kaikeyi, was Kaikeyi was Kaikeya. Kaikeya is the king of Kekeya. Kekeya is the kingdom's name, and the king's name is Kaikeya, and his daughter's name is Kaikeyi or was Kaikeyi. So she was the only daughter of Kaikeya, and Dasharatha Maharaj was already married for a long time. He had Kaushalya and Sumitra, and they didn't have any children. So when he sought the hand of Kaikeyi, Kaikeya asked the king, he asked Dasharatha Maharaj that you're asking me for my daughter, and she's my only daughter. So what is the guarantee that her son will get any kind of prominence in your kingdom? What if your other wives, they get sons or they get children, and then everything, all the wealth, everything goes to them? What will happen to my daughter? So Kaikeya had asked this question even before giving Kaikeyi in marriage to Dasharatha Maharaj. So Dasharatha Maharaj told, my wives, they have not borne a child till now, so I don't think they will have sons anymore. So if at all anybody is going to have sons, then it will be Kaikeyi only. So Kaikeyi's son is going to get the kingdom already. This is a given, so you don't have to worry about it. So then Kaikeyi, a very smart man, he said, I'm not just going to believe whatever you say. You please give it in writing. Okay, so this was an ancient practice in Treta Yuga. It is known as Kanya Shulka. Kanya Shulka. This is like the person who's going to get married. That means a man who's going to get married will give dowry to the girl. Okay, so to the bride. Then, so he said that you give it in writing that my daughter's son will get the kingdom. So he actually wrote Kanya Shulka like that, and then he gave it to Kaikeya, saying that your daughter's son will become the future emperor of Ayodhya or Kosala. So this was already told by Maharaj Dasharatha, and this was not known to many people. Only three people knew. Okay, so Kaikeya knew. Dasharatha Maharaj knew. Very good. Okay, that is intelligent. Who else would have known? Kaikeyi, okay. Who else? Let me see. Okay, the person who knew was Vasishtha. Vasishtha, the Kula Guru of the whole dynasty, Ikshvaku dynasty, he knew. Only three people knew. And actually, Maharaj Dasharatha did not want Kaikeyi to know, but then at some other point in time, because of parental affection, Kaikeya told the secret to Kaikeyi. Kaikeyi did not do anything, did not speak anything, but she kept this in her heart. So therefore, she did not feel like that she was doing any mistake, even though Mantara had given her the idea of the boon and all that. She did not invoke this Kanya Shulka, this contract that was written between them, because she knew that she was on the right side. Already Maharaj Dasharatha has told. So why is it that she was not doing anything wrong? That's what she was thinking. Then you know what all incidents followed. And Kaikeyi, Kaushalya and Sumitra, they were very, very close to each other. That is why. And Kaikeyi was also extremely fond of Lord Rama. So he thought, Maharaj Dasharatha thought, that all of these things would be forgotten. Lord Rama, I mean Rama, my son, he's the most qualified to become the emperor, and therefore he should be made emperor. And anyway, everybody loves. So until Mantara again poked her nose and then started intervening in this whole scheme of things, everything was going on very nicely. Of course, we understand that this is all by the arrangement of the Lord. Lord Rama had already come to kill. Now I'll tell you how Ravana, even to get killed by Lord Rama. You see, in the previous yuga, Lord Vishnu appeared, Lord Narayana appeared in two forms, one as Varahadev and the other as Narsingadev. How somebody can even become qualified to get killed by the Lord? You see, when Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu, they were originally Jaya and Vijaya. Jaya and Vijaya are the two doorkeepers of Lord Narayana in Vaikuntha. In Vaikuntha, they were cursed by the four Kumaras, the four sages who were sons of Lord Brahma. They were actually cursed by the four sons of Lord Brahma to come down to the material world and take three births as asuras or rakshasas, right? So this is how these three occurrences happened and they were killed. Now, do you know that there was also a fourth occurrence? Only in this particular Chaturyuga, Jaya Vijaya also appeared in Kali Yuga. Do you know who were they? Yes, Jagai and Madai, and they were delivered by Lord Chaitanya, again another incarnation of Lord Krishna. Okay, so fantastic. So even to get killed is a very, very big thing. You see, in Treta Yuga, Lord Rama killed so many of those demons, right? Now, all of those demons got liberated because they were killed by Lord Rama. So to get killed by the Lord is not an ordinary thing. So we'll understand how this Ravana got the qualification to get killed by Lord Rama. You know that incident, right? I narrated in the camp also that there was this incident where Sugriva jumped and he fought with Ravana. You remember that, right? Yeah. So at that point in time, Sugriva had done one thing which, you know, normally people are not supposed to do. He became very small at one time when Ravana was doing all his mayavi business. You know, he became very small and he was going around Ravana and he was constantly spitting on Ravana. So when Sugriva jumped back to Lord Rama, of course, Lord Rama was upset that without telling him, he went to meet Ravana. Ravana, for two reasons, he was very, very upset. One, that he fought with Sugriva with his own might, without invoking those mayavi powers, he was not able to defeat Sugriva. Sugriva was bashing him up like anything. Okay, so that was one thing. The second was, he's the ruler of the 14 worlds and this Vanara is spitting on his face. So he was extremely upset about, you know, all these things. So Lord Rama also asked, he said, Sugriva, why? Okay, you went there, you fought with him, but why did you spit on him? Why were you spitting on him? And then Sugriva said, oh, we are Vanaras. These rules and regulations are only for human beings, not for us. We can do whatever we want. Like that. Sugriva, I mean, he didn't say disrespectfully to Lord Rama like that, but he said something like that, that no, these rules don't apply to us. After the spitting incident, Ravana was feeling terrible. How could this happen to me? You know, like this, one monkey, he has come and he has spat on me. This is bad. He thought, okay, my time has come, but I am Trilokeshwar Ravan and I can conquer time, because at one point in time, he had fought with Yamaraj and Kaladanda was there along with Yamaraj, and Mrityu and Kala, both were along with Yamaraj, and Yamaraj was about to kill Ravana. But then Lord Brahma, without being visible to anyone else, he came and told Yamaraj, no, don't do this, because Lord Vishnu is going to appear as Lord Rama and he is supposed to kill this demon. You don't do it. So after that, Yamaraj just disappeared from there. So Ravana was getting bashed up like anything at that time also. But he thought, because Yamaraj just disappeared from there, he thought, oh, I won, like, like that. So like small kids, no? So he thought that he has won and he came. So he was thinking that I can conquer time because Kaladanda was there along with Yamaraj. How I can conquer it, I don't know, but somehow it will happen, he was thinking. Then he was wondering, but still, I should take the help of some great king or Kshatriya warrior. So he was thinking, shall I take the help of these Devatas? But these Devatas, I have only defeated them. What, they will come and help me? They are useless. Like that, he thought. Then he's thinking, in my line, is there anybody who's a great warrior whom I can take help from? Do you know? Yeah, he went to Bali Maharaj. Bali Maharaj was living in a planet known as Sutala, in the Loka, known as Sutala Loka. Actually, Bali Maharaj was pushed down by Vamanadeva. When he kept his feet, lotus feet on his head, he had pushed him down to Sutala. So he went to Sutala and then he wanted to enter Sutala, Bali Maharaj's palace. But who was guarding there? Who was guarding the palace? Do you know? Vamanadev himself was guarding the palace of Bali Maharaj. So Vamanadev, with a club on his shoulder, he was guarding and he was walking back and forth, you know, like that, backward and forward, guarding the gate. And Ravana came there and he looked at him. Ravana also travels with his club and his sword. So he said, hey, who is this dwarf? No, a small creature. He came there and tried to get into the gate. Vamanadev put his club there and said, like that. So you cannot go, he told. Then he didn't speak. Vamanadev had taken a vow of not speaking, of complete silence. So still, Ravana was very angry that Vamanadev was doing that. He didn't know who he was. So he was very angry, but then he didn't show it out. Then he was thinking, okay, I will try another method. And he thought like that and he became invisible. It was one of the things that he could do, one of the siddhis that Ravana had. He became invisible. Now, can anybody become invisible from God? Is that possible? Not possible. Not possible at all. So Lord Vishnu, Vamanadev saw him and again he put the club. This time again he put the club. So then he couldn't go. Then he thought, okay, I will become very small and I will go through the door, he was thinking. So he became very small and tried to enter very quickly. But Vamanadev, he took his lotus feet and put it on his body. Vamanadev was just standing there and Ravana was screaming, like that. He was screaming and gasping for air. But because Vamanadev's lotus feet touched the body of Ravana, that is why he became qualified to receive the arrows of Lord Rama and die. Okay, so otherwise Ravana had no qualification. Ravana did not even have the qualification to die by the hands of Lord Rama.